Is it okay if I speak to it and say, I need to put on? I mean, I can speak here, I just need some game to work. I can get it there or not.
Oh,
or,
no.
Okay? If I go here, let's see. I'm aware that I'll be recorded, so, but I don't want to entertain that. I want to share what I believe God has inspired me to share with you guys. But I always want to pray, because we're not here to learn from someone. We're here to learn from God. And everything we need to learn is revealed in the scripture, and I also believe in the spirit of prophecy. And God sent my wife for these last days. You know why? Because the people is not reading the Bible. To help us read her letters and then go back to the Bible and understand it clearer. Right? So, before I begin, I just want to ask you to bow your heads as we pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that it's still the Sabbath day and we can still worship you. Father, I just ask that you humble me. But Lord, I will just share whatever the Holy Spirit has inspired me. Father, we want to learn from you. We want to sit at your feet. And Father, be able to hear the will of God in our lives. Lord, no speaker is great. And oftentimes we are more guilty because we don't live what we preach. And so I pray, Father, that it will be you speaking today. That, Lord, we will be careful to give you all the glory and the praise. Teach us, Father, as we hear from your word, we will not just be hearers, but also doers. We ask your Holy Spirit now. We ask, Father, that we may have the spirit of humility and meekness, that we might learn and be willing, Father, to be taught by you. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I just want to share first why I think I should be sharing this message to you. Why I think this is important and why I feel about it personally. Before I share the message, I say, I'm sharing a message, but you don't feel like this is really important. You know what I'm saying? So, what I want to share tonight is what I felt. It's not just me who feels that this is a problem. This is a worldwide problem, but I think it's a greater problem here in the Philippines. And the problem that we're having in this church, and I've been listening to many speakers, and I've been observing it myself, is that we're lacking men in church. Am I right? Maybe not in this church, but maybe if you go to AUP, one thing you will notice is that whenever there's a spiritual program, there's so many girls attending the prayer meeting, but there's hardly any guys. And the problem is that we have a lot of godly women who cannot find enough godly men, so what ends up happening? They find them outside. And so am I speaking about the men here in the church, what God wants us as men to be in the Bible? I'm not saying I've arrived. I'm here to speak what the Bible teaches because I also want to be a man of God. And I'm sure young people here, you want to marry someone who is a man after God's own heart. Am I right? And so today I'll be sharing about the men of God. Another reason is that last night I went to a church. I don't want to mention what church it is because I'm not here to criticize the church, right? The church is important. And we need more people in the church. The problem was, when I went to the church, I noticed that in the program, the soul leader was a woman. There's nothing wrong with that. The opening prayer was a woman. The speaker was a woman. The closing prayer was by a woman. I was thinking, I was looking around the church, where are the men? They're not there. Now, I see that when I look at the Bible, when I look at Acts, men and women
was used by God. The problem is that we are lacking men. I'm not saying women, criticizing women, right? Women are important. The problem is that because we lack men and men are not stepping up, the problem is that women are doing what they should be doing, including what men should be doing. Do you understand what I'm saying? There is our China, which we want revival and reformation. When I was in England, it's always seen as around the world, revival and reformation. But there is no revival and reformation if there is no challenge for men to be men of God. Do you understand what I'm saying? We have ministries back at home. My mom is heavily involved in this. It's called the Women's Ministry. And the women are very active in prayer. When there is prayer, when there's outreach, most of the time, is what you will be buying. Women. The guys, they just go there because, you know, they like those who are going there. But they're not the head, not they're the tail. Another thing why I'm sharing this is that, I don't know if it's just my observation. I could be wrong. Correct me if I'm wrong. But if you go around the churches, you'll see the same trend. Week of prayer, earliest, female. All the men, what are they doing? Especially young people. Laying God down. Is that the kind of man God wants in the future? Is that a kind of man who will lead hopes in the future for Jesus coming? You see, there is attacks for young people, but my focus today is on men. But you will understand that this is not just about men. This is also important for women because men will influence you. In fact, the Bible says in Genesis, especially those who are single, this will challenge you. So you don't fall for a boy, you fall for a man of God. In fact, the Bible says when sin fell into this world, Eve ate of the fruit, right? Eve ate of the fruit. And when Eve ate of the fruit, she gave it to Adam. Now when both of them ate of the fruit, they realized that they were naked. Am I right? Do you remember the story? Okay, this is like children's story, so I hope you children also listen up. So they ate and they were naked, and that's what they did next. What did they do? When they ate of the fruit, they realized they were naked. The LY says, the patriarch and prophet, the robe of light was removed and they saw their nakedness. But notice that when they were naked, what did they do next? Ate the fruit, they became naked, what did they do next? Do you know what they did? They hide themselves. They realized they were naked, they soon be glimpsed and they hide. When Jesus came in the garden, did Jesus say, Eve, where are you? No. Who did he call? He called Adam. Why? Because Eve was deceived. Did Adam knew that what Eve was doing was wrong? Yes. He knew full well that by eating of this fruit, he was rebelling under the rule of God. You see, Eve actually was deceived, but Adam knew. In fact, Adam White wrote it in Patriarchs and Prophets. When he looked into the eyes of Eve, he was so sad that he was going to lose her. And so he would rather die than to live without her. Am I hitting you? Adam would rather die than to live without her. That's why he ate the fruit. Have you ever heard another love story that's similar like that? Romeo and Juliet? He's a copycat of what actually happened in the Garden of Eden. There are many men who are willing to die but to do the will of God. And because Adam ate of the fruit, notice that they only realized they were naked after Adam ate. Meaning, Eve was still eating on the fruit and he showed it to Adam. But she didn't think, she didn't realize they were naked until Adam ate of the fruit. And guess what? When Adam ate of the fruit, that's when sin entered into this world. Not when Eve ate. You know why? Because Adam was the authority. Adam was the head. Now, am I teaching saying that the men are better than the women? No. But you cannot have two leaders. A leader has to have a follower. And a follower has to have a leader. Because if you have two leaders, no one is following. You cannot have a relationship. Nothing will ever be done. And so Adam was created first to be a leader, and because he ate of the fruit, guess who Jesus came looking for? Was he looking for Eve? No, he was looking for Adam, because Adam was the head. So you know who was the great of all? Not Eve. It was Adam. He was not deceived by the devil. He knew what he was doing and deserved it. So why am I sharing you this? Because many of our churches today, and I see it in AUB, we are lacking men. Men who are godly and who are spiritual. They are caught up with sports, LeBron James, his new players, Porzingis, they're all these NBA players, Dota, LOL, and all these things that they're not interested in. These spiritual things. Now, do we think Jesus is going to come when these are the kind of men, young men we have in church, who will be our future? Now, I used to be there, but I just want us, I just want to make us realize why this is important, what I'm about to say. Another thing is that, why I'm talking about this, is that I just got into a relationship, and in this relationship, within about a year and a half, I will get married, because I arranged marriage with someone who's Indian. And, well, I arranged the marriage with my parents. And, praise God, that their parents, my parents will meet, and we will be in GBH. After that, next year, the year after that, 2019, I got the grace to get married. Now, for me, I prefer to have been married a little later, because looking at myself, I don't feel like I am ready. And so, I was thinking, Lord, how can I prepare myself? Because it's not just having someone, you're going to be a father. And to be a father, to be a leader of the home, they said the perfect man has three P's. He has to be a provider, a priest, and a protector. You have to be all of that. I was thinking, maybe I'm not going to provide it, because I'm still, you know, we're still going to be studying, hopefully, in med school. But anyway, God will take care of that when we graduate. That won't be a problem, by God's grace. Priest, I'm protector. I think, I'm bigger than her, I can protect her. Maybe I should work out a little bit. But priest. And so I was thinking to myself, what can I do to prepare myself? So that when that time comes, I will be ready. And so this is why I'm sharing it today, because I believe that it's an important subject that we need to learn and something that we need to meditate upon. So as I will share this, it's not too long, it's actually very short, but I just want us to understand some things. I want us to just look and examine that perhaps something is not right in the church. Our men need to be challenged, and we need the help of the women to make the men realize what they're supposed to be. There was a joke that a preacher said, you know, back in my days, it's a joke. He said, back in my days, before I could remove a woman's clothes, I had to have a diploma, a car, and a home. But now these days, men cannot have any of that, and they can do it. And so, why did they say that? I was listening to this in a sermon. It says, today, men are falling behind. Why? Because the women are giving themselves away too easily, not challenging the man. You see the problem? The problem doesn't just lie with the way men are, but also because the way women does not challenge the man. So I want to pray again, and then I will share what God's will is for men in the church, and how women can help us. So we pray our Father. Father, we ask for your Holy Spirit as we continue this message. Father, we want to be men of God. We want to learn from Jesus himself. So Lord, please guide us now in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. In Adventist Home, page 117, paragraph 2, look what Ellen White says. Adventist Home. Do I be as quick and direct as possible? In Adventist Home, page 117, paragraph 2, this is what Ellen White writes. The husband is to be as a savior in his family. Notice what Ellen White said. Not the mother, not the older sister, or the older, not the kuya, not the ate. The Bible says the husband is to be as a savior in his family. Now what does that mean? How can the husband be as the savior of the family? It means that he has to be like the savior himself. That's a powerful thought. But it's not actually over the top statement if you study the Bible. Because if you take, for example, Joshua, Go to Joshua. Joshua chapter 24, verses 15. Look what the Bible says. If you go there with me, Joshua 24, 15. It's not actually a very over-the-top statement. The example of Joshua, look what it says in Joshua 24, 15. Listen to how he addressed the people of Israel as they were settling down in Canaan. Moses just died. Joshua was not the new leader. Joshua. And now, as they were entering the land of milk and honey, they had to go through Jericho and they were killed. They had to overcome many people and they were destroyed. Now, everybody now has their own land. They're building their homes. They're starting their families. And everybody that are have their lot here, they're all the enemies that were threatening them, they removed, except some. While they were about to build their houses, look what Joshua said, because he's about to die. Now therefore, Joshua 24:15. Now therefore, fear the Lord, and serve him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the gods which your fathers on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. He says, hey, I'm about to die, and I don't know who's going to take after me. But you guys are not going to fight anymore. But I want you to remember to fear the Lord. Serve him in truthfulness. And he says, put away the gods which your father have served on the other side of the flood in Egypt. And he says, and if it seems evil unto you to serve the Lord, what did he say? Choose you this day whom you will serve. But look what he said. But as for me and, what does he say? My house. For a man to say such a statement means that that man had authority in his home. That meant the man was not under the skirt. That meant he was the leader. And not only was he ruling by force, he was not under, but by example and authority. That man could say, you can serve your gods. You can go back. Now you have your land, you have your maybe you can go and serve your idols again. You know, sometimes I say, as Christians, when we pray, Lord, please give me a boyfriend, please give me an A. We're so faithful. We're so like religious. But when we get the A, when we get the boyfriend, the girlfriend, you know what the tendency is? We go back our old ways. And so Joshua is saying, now you have the land of Israel. And probably wala ka ng obligation. You have no obligation to serve him anymore. Because look at you now. You have your house, you have your land. And you have your new life. And he's saying, fear God. Don't forget what he did in your life. And put away the gods. Because he knows the temptation now is, hey, what's up, my neighbor? What are you worshiping? He knows that their neighboring countries, they're not going to consider their ways. They're going to live like them. And he says, but for me and my house, you can serve, you can backslide. Yeah, I know. We will serve the Lord. Do you understand what that meant? It meant that that man was so bold. Like, I know your kids are probably misbehaving, but not my kids. But you know what he said? As for me. Before he said his house, what does that tell us? That if we're going to have men of God who will bring heaven on earth, lead families to go to heaven, it has to start with themselves. Do you understand what I'm saying? Joshua could say, for me and my house, we will serve the Lord, because he was the leader. Which meant that everyone in his family, from his wife, from his eldest to his youngest, he knew they were serving the Lord. Why? Because the father served the Lord, therefore the mother served the Lord, and the children, because they see the parents serve the Lord, the rest of the whole who served the Lord. Notice that he started with himself. Before he could say, my house or we, Joshua says, me. Joshua could say that his home will serve the Lord because he himself served the Lord. Now, young people, girls, before you consider a guy who will not cheat on you, who will not use you, ask the question, is he serving the Lord? Is he godly? Because I know you don't want to be heartbroken. His leadership began with him. How he lives his life will determine how his family will follow him. The reason why he could say that his family are willing to follow the same path was not merely by the authority he assumes as the head of the home, but because of the example he set. He served God in and out of the home. The problem why some of our families are not growing, the church is not growing, is because the men are not doing their work. Only a few are standing as spiritual leaders. When there's worship in the home, guess who wants to know worship in the home? The mother. The father will wake up, you know, the one NBA. Remember the one Pacquiao. But when it comes to serving God, with my mommy, I'm checking on my computer. Do you know there's a survey that says that when the father is a spiritual home, the kids are less likely to leave the church. But when the kids said, I can't remember the specific study, but I can't remember the numbers. But one thing I do remember is that they said when the spiritual leader is the woman, because the husband is now, less of the children will stay in the church. Which means the influence of the father is much greater than the mother. This is not making this up. This is not because the Bible said this. They did a survey in America. They did a survey on the kids who left the church. And they asked them, Among your parents, who was more spiritual? And you know what they said? They said that the mother was more spiritual than the father. Those who stayed in church, they asked them, from your parents, in your own observation, who was more spiritual, the mother or the father? The greater percentage said it was the
content.
I'll find that specific, just came to my mind as I was mentioning. The good thing about the message that we can learn from Joshua was he was a spiritual person, both inside the church and in the home and outside the home. The problem is that when we go to church, many of our, there are some guys, I know this is the truth because I have friends who are guys and talk about it. Their father comes to church and they're very, very spiritual.
They're the elder,
they dress like this, they share the Sabbath school lesson, they do this, but then when they go at home, the things that comes out of their mouth is not the same as what they're teaching in the Sabbath school lesson. They're super spiritual in church. They're like performing. Now it's time to act. Time to act holy. Time to act spiritual. But when they're in the home, they're not the same. Now, do you think the young man wants to serve God knowing their father cannot be consistent? Joshua was not like this. Joshua was spiritual in the home and outside the home. He must have been a consistent man. A man his wife and his own children could respect and follow. Now, if you look at your father and you don't see the same way, if you're a young boy, listen to me, you can do otherwise. You don't have to follow at the same time. The father determines much of how and what the home should be. Connecting with God, like Joshua, he was able to keep his home set apart and dedicated for God because his godly and consistent influence. Not only did others see that he knew God and his very own family could testify, his own family could testify to the sincerity of his faith. When he says, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. If you ask the wife, what would the wife say? Yeah, my husband served the Lord. If you ask the children, yes, my daddy serves the Lord. He was not ashamed. Now, fathers in the church, can your children say, yes, my dad is the same in church as well as in the house? You see, the house of Joshua, speaking to men and women, you can challenge your men, would not allow Egyptian music in his home. Would not allow Egyptian television programs in his home. Would not allow Canaanite food in the table. Because as for me and my house, I will serve the Lord. His house was not the same like the world. If you look at the bookshelves, nothing Egyptian, Canaanite, Amorite, you name it, Hushite, I don't know what, all those other Philistine media entertainment was there. His home was a home of God. It was not the same. And if we're going to have a revival in our church, we need men to have a leadership that is different. Men who leave their house and home different to the way the world leaves their home. That's why he can say, put away your gods, which you serve on the other side, but as for me and my house. He had so much of what goes on in his home. Guess what? He brought his home back. This is my home. This is my house. But the problem is that men are not claiming what God has rightly given them. They're not owning. They're letting the mothers do what they're supposed to be doing. Consider also Noah. I'm talking about real men of God. Not perfect, but examples that we can learn from. Noah. Noah literally lived in the last few days before the flood. Do we believe that we are living in the last few days before Jesus comes? Do you believe that? Noah had a similar experience. He was living in the last few days or years before
for the flood, and God was looking for a man who would be a leader for the new family that would repopulate the earth. In fact, the Bible says that God was looking for a righteous man. And guess who was the only man that was righteous in his age? He was
Noah.
In fact, it was Noah's righteousness that saved his wife, that saved his sons, and his daughters-in-law. Notice, it says in Genesis, I want to take it to Genesis and then I'm going to wrap this up. I keep the message not that long, but I'm just trying to emphasize some things. If you go to Genesis, I want us to just appreciate something. In Genesis, it says here, Genesis chapter 6, now it came to pass, verse 1, when men began to multiply the face of the earth, the daughters were born to them, and the sons of God saw that the daughters of men were what? Beautiful. And they took them as wives for themselves, of whom they chose. And the Lord said, my spirit shall not strive with man forever, for he is indeed flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. There were giants after the earth, and look what it says. And God saw, verse 5, that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent and thought of the heart was evil continually. And the Lord was sorry that he had made man in the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. So God said, I want to start again. But to start again, I have to find a man. A man who will not lead the world into this mess. Men, young boys in here, including myself, can God look at you and entrust you to have a home that will be not like this one? In fact, it was really God's righteousness. He's the only person that was actually righteous about sin was Noah. The world became so simple, everybody forgot God. And by that time, Enoch was already heaven. Who was the righteous man left? Noah. So that tells me the wife was not righteous. The son was not righteous. The second son was not righteous. The first, but because of the example of Noah, they were saved. Let me tell you something. I want you to appreciate what a man of God, if he takes what the role God gave him, can do in our church, in our family, and in the world. Look what it says.
Right.
Noah found grace in the eyes of God. Genesis 6, verses 8 and 9. Eyes of the Lord. Now Noah was a just man and perfect in his generation. And look what the Bible says. And Noah walked with God. But instead of taking him to heaven, he took him to the heart to do something. Now let me tell you something. How many years did Noah preach? 120 years. What was his sermon about? Jesus is going to destroy the world with a flood. Repent and come to the ark. Now, how many kinds of sermons did he touch on? What topic? Just one. Well, let me tell you something. If he was a hypocrite, if he was inconsistent, if he was proud, egotistical, self-centered, critical of his children, of his wife, if he was dictatorial, impatient, none of his children, especially his wife, would have believed his message, nor would they desire to enter and stay in the ark with such a man. I mean, you know how many days he stayed with Noah? I can't remember, I forgot, but very... like 6 months, stayed on the ark. More. Now, would you stay with a man like that? Like in a building floating in the ocean somewhere? No, you wouldn't, right? This is a challenge to all fathers and future fathers. Good boys here, listen to me. God expects us to be a spiritual leader and a priest of our home. We are to act as spiritual guardians to our children and reserve a godly family instead of allowing outside influence to determine what our homes should be. We are to lead by example, not only by authority. The character of God should be reflected in us if we truly are to be savior of our homes. It was really Noah's example, not his sermon, that saved his home. Because I can preach a powerful sermon here, but if people know who I really am in their home, my wife, future wife, and future kids cannot see consistency with the message I'm preaching to the life I'm living, no one would help me in the heart. That was Noah. Would you believe that there will be rain and there's no rain? There was never rain in the earth. That you're going to have a boat built on top of a mountain when the lake is over there? How are you going to take it there? You see, it was crazy. People call it crazy. But the wife, the children, and their children's wives saw the way he lived his life. And they were convinced. They were persuaded. Not by his sermon, because his sermon sounds very unrealistic. Because the life he lived, they saw that he lived what he preached. And he said, maybe, just maybe, there might be blood. Because my father is not crazy. He's a lovely man. He's so loving. He's so consistent. He's so sincere. How can a man who walks with God make things up? It must be true. Examine what Abraham, he must have been a very good father to have saved his home. I want to talk about one more man, and then we can probably end. Examine what God said to Abraham and his role as the head of the home. Look what it says in Genesis 18. I want to take you there. Genesis 18, verse 18 to 19. This is what it says in Genesis 18 to 19. Look what it says. Seeing that Abraham shall surely be a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be what? Blessed in him. God called Abraham to what? Be a mighty nation, not just for himself, but all the other nations will be blessed in him. Are you a Jew? No. But why are we believing in God? Because of one man's faithfulness. We are the other nations that have been blessed by him. That's why we are called Father Abraham has many sons. Many sons have Father Abraham. We are those sons because we are not Jewish. Look what 19 says. For I know that he will command his children. Look, before he blessed the nations around the world, look what he says. For I know him. He will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he has spoken him. He's trying to say, before the whole world can be blessed, I know that Abraham can rule his house. So if a man cannot be a man of God, a leader, a priest, a provider, a protector, a spiritual leader in his home, how can the church bless the entire nation? We're trying to evangelize, and we don't, we're trying to do outreach, but we fail to focus on the ministry of inreach. That has to happen first. It has to begin in the home before the mission field. Now, the reason why Abraham, I'm trying to wrap this up, Abraham's household would obey his command was because he obeyed God's command first. We need more men of God, not Homer Simpsons. Now that's how the world wants to portray men. Homer Simpson, funny guy. That's your role model. They're, you know, the wife is the smartest, intelligent, the hardworking, but usually the man is the one who sits in the couch, stupid, or is drinking and eating donuts. That's the kind of men that the world is trying to portray husbands are. And you know what? You know why they portray them like that? Because the truth is, many of them are like that. That's why you call it stereotype. Why? Because it meets many types that exist. That's not the kind of men God wants. Our family guys. Men who others look up and respect. That's the kind of men God wants. And I'm sure women, that's the kind of men we want. Am I right? Godly men who the world and their very own family members can see that they know, obey, follow, and walk with God. Unless this happens, I will tell you, the church will not have a revival. Because the church is not going, the Holy Spirit is not just going to fall on women. It also has to fall in men. And unless the men think of their role, then everyone else will follow after them. These are the kind of husband and father's God is calling all men to be, calling me to be. Leaders, not couch potatoes. The head, not the tail. The spiritual priest, not the spectator. The genuine ones, not the hypocrites. I want to read one quote as I end. I was going to read a lot of things. The Bible, how an elder should be, how a deacon should be, how a youth should be. But I think this quote will make the conclusion. The greatest one of the world is the one of men. Men who will not be bought or sold. Men who in their inmost souls are true and honest. Men who do not fear to call sin by its right name. Men whose conscience is as true to duty as the needle to the pole. Men who will stand for the right. Oh, the heavens all. Brethren, God is calling all of us to be men and women of God. But the problem is, if you look around, there's hardly any men. And if there are in church, they're sitting back, crossing their arms, leaning back, and letting others do what God called them to do and be. Unless the man knows what they're supposed to be doing, unless they realize that you're supposed to be more spiritual than your wife, more spiritual than your girlfriend, more prayerful than your wife, more prayerful than your brother and your sister, unless they realize that they are called to God to be leaders. If your family goes to hell, the first person God will go and call is not your mother, not your wife, it's you. What did you do? As the savior of the home, did you lead out in worship? Did you pray for your children? Did you ask your wife forgiveness for being unlike Jesus? Did you hug your sons out sorry? The Bible says, fathers, do not provoke your son. Were you a savior of your home, or were you the devil in it? My friends, God wants men of God. And He's calling for us. You know why? Because when we take our stand in the sight of God, our wives will follow us. Our girlfriend would admire us. Our children would want to be like Daddy. Why is Daddy like Jesus? There's a lot of women's ministry. But guess what? There's hardly any men. Ministries for men. And in AUB, we began this this ministry, but sadly it stopped because you was that busy. And we started a group. Because I noticed this was a problem, and I talked to my godly friends. It's good to have godly friends, right? It's a blessing. We prayed about it, and I asked all my theology friends, hey, do you see there's a problem? Yeah, there's a problem. And so we prayed and we started a group which met a few times, and I shared some of the first messages, and I asked my other friends to share the message, and I started asking pastors and teachers to share the message. And you know what, that group, that small group, we meet every Friday, and it grew and grew and grew, but sadly it kind of dissolved now because we got busy. But do you know what I saw when we had a group of men talking about their struggles, talking about things they're afraid to talk about when earth is around? Talking about how to be, studying how to be a father, studying how to be a spiritual leader. You know what? I saw a change. There's something about when man thinks it's so manly to be like that. Because now, sadly, some of the programs which they are led by a man does not appeal to the masculinity of some men. But if we encourage our men to be what God wants them to be, not discourage, criticize them, then they're going to be more like that. But encourage them, not sermonize and attack them, have ministries, study the Word of God, and look at the Bible, the greatest men, there's hardly any women there. Why? Not because men are better than women, no. God understood their role. Praise God for women, you know why? Because when a man is not doing his job, a woman is willing to do it for him. But guess what? It's very hard to be the father and the mother at the same time. So, I share this message not just to challenge fathers now, and the fathers to be, but to challenge myself, because I am not where I should be. But if the world is going to accept the gospel, we need more Joshua's. Amen? We need more Abraham's, who will control their children. You know, I realize I am not what my father said I should be. What I do and who I am is not because of what he said, but because of what he did, and I was copying what he did. You know what I'm trying to say? By beholding, you become changed. You know, some of my ways, my mannerism, I get it from my dad. The good ones and the bad ones. And sometimes he will tell me, Khim, don't be like this. Because I see it, I still do it. And so what is the point? The point is, we are to be examples. Read that text. The husband. If you're not yet married, but it's okay. The husband is to be as a savior, not the savior. Because the only savior is Jesus Christ. But a savior in his family. And how to be like that is to be like the savior. May we learn to walk like God. May we desire to be like Jesus. And I can assure you, when men take up their role and stand on Jesus' side, behind them is the wife, the eldest, the middle child, and the youngest, if you have three children. And you can say, as for me, because it began with me first, then my house, we